Hi everyone, my name is Francesca Ferrando. I'm very, very excited for you to meet two very interesting people who are working on the topic of the posthuman. This is a series of interviews entitled Posthumans, in which we give space to artists, scholars, scientists who are engaging with the term posthuman. Why is that important? Why is the new term to redefine humanity? So we're going to address this question with, again, two very interesting speakers. We have a very different approach from different nations, ideas, generation, countries. So the posthuman, it's happening. It's a new paradigm that is happening, so many new different ideas, so many different school of thoughts that are working on this, posthumanists, transhumanists, anti-humanists. We want to have them all in this space to discuss with us what does it mean to be posthuman. So we're going to ask this question specifically in relation to posthuman bodies with two very interesting people who are working specifically on posthumanism in relation to embodiment. I'm very, very pleased to introduce you to Chiarina Chan. She's an architecture based in New York, in Beijing, and also in the south of China. So she's going to really explain more in detail about arts and the posthuman. I'm also very excited to introduce you to Agathe Francois. She's a PhD candidate in research creation at the University of Montreal in Canada. She also was one of our speakers last year here at NYU for the Global Summit that we had in 2018. So again, very, very welcome, Chiarina and Agathe. Thank you so much for being here. So we're going to ask both of you a very crucial question. Something that you have been working from the arts or from the academic field, what does it mean to be posthuman in the 21st century, and what does it mean, the notion of posthuman bodies? So we're going to start with Agathe, if you don't mind, also introduce briefly your work and then addressing this question.
Well, thanks a lot, Francesca. I think that being a posthuman body today, nowadays, is something very abstract for many, many people who don't know a thing about what's happening right now concerning new technologies and their use with bodies. Just to be a bit clear, my work and my focus is mainly on imaginaries. So imaginaries of posthuman bodies. The fact is that it is very, very difficult for many people, and even in science fiction literature, in academic papers, in many views on the posthuman, to imagine posthuman bodies. Why is that? Because we are very still reasoning through anthropomorphic prisms, through individualist prisms, and through humanist prisms. And one of the aims of my work is basically to work on imagination and find alternative narratives than the ones that pervade today. And I'm thinking more precisely of the ones you can see in everyday medias, like Elon Musk just claiming that he's going to let us go to Mars in a decade or so. His new Neuralink company that is trying to find ways to connect human brains to machines. And this is a very linear way of seeing posthuman bodies and very largely posthuman future. And I'm thinking that we shouldn't be obliged to think and to desire through those narratives, and there are ways to create collaborative narratives to think differently about those technologies, and I guess that's what I'm trying to do, actually.
Thank you so much, Agathe. Yeah, I found very original your approach to posthuman bodies, because you really try to imagine posthuman bodies outside of an anthropomorphic paradigm, which is very true. It's the most common idea about the future, not really thinking just through human bodies that somehow become posthuman. And I like your challenge of trying to go outside of not only humanistic paradigm, but also the anthropomorphic paradigm, which is so ingrained since very young age. We learn about other animals with totally humanized forms, and then now we're learning about robots as they were little nice humans. But the difference, the ontological difference, is completely erased in this anthropomorphization. So I think that your work is very original on that, and we are really looking forward to, you know, to read your book that is going to come out of your PhD dissertation. And in this sense, I would really like to get Chiarina into the conversation. Chiarina is actually working with many interesting artists in the US, in Europe, and in China. The work that she's developing at the moment is with Moon Ribas, who is this very famous cyborg artist who has a microchip so that she can feel earthquakes in on Earth or also on the Moon, that is connected also to her name, Moon Ribas. She's actually having a show coming out in New York this December, and then they're going to bring the show around in different countries. So we want to hear more about this through Chiarina. So Chiarina, in your work, how do you engage in the notion of posthuman bodies? And also, because you have such a good worldview about the topic of the posthuman, if you can also bring some different insights that you might have witnessed in the arts in Beijing or in South China, or again in Madrid, in Barcelona, in the New York, if you see regional differences.
Thank you, Professor. I'm so glad that I'm here and had a chance to talk about like my engagement in posthuman. So start with, I think it comes with an urge, actually, like the reason why we are doing this and why we have to, you know, shape artists and thoughts to realize a call for interconnection. I think that's my point. So as you have described the writings and imaginary, I think that's fascinating. And my start point is actually because I've witnessed a fact that, you know, Moon Ribas and Neil Harbison, they're already existing. Like, we already have people starting to transform themselves in the cyborg bodies. So it is there. And it's a question of how we as, you know, art producers and curators, what messages we want to bring to people. So I actually started from a background in criminal psychology and art. So I've always been concerning about, you know, our nowadays the humanity or like human crisis, which is currently, you know, everywhere. And we've have this feeling of a shared wild, feral wild anxiety all over the world, in China, here in Europe, you know, and it is also a very important part of when we think about the landscape of when we say posthuman. It is how we going to be in this together, you know, the us, the non-human bodies and, you know, non-human or other creatures, not just human body or animals. So to me, my approach is to witness first of a disconnection and the severe, you know, suffer of how we've been disconnected with all the others, like the nature, and also, you know, we're connected from ancestors and a lot of relations, I would say. And so that this kind of cultivate a perspective for me that when we talk about the posthuman bodies, it needs to break the sense of a very bilateral, you know, the sense that divides human and cyborg, divides like human and nature. So it is really to kind of to see a very nomadic, you know, subjectivities inside this. It is really, you know, how what kind of landscape we can reimagine. So this is how we started to collaborate with Moon Ribas and Cyborg Foundation, because I think the beauty of her transformation is that the reason why they do that, it's not for a human enhancement. It's not for the sake of, you know, future and a linear progression, but it is because they want to reconnect with the otherness of our nature, which actually interesting because thinking about before the human-centric time, we are actually interrelated with so many elements, and that is a that is it's almost like a linkage. And now it's getting to revitalize, it's to revitalize that sense again, to put all the elements together. So I think the beautiful part of that is through the body, it's a media to connect with multi others. And that is how we, you know, starting to realize this project. And I think that's a very different point of view when I was in China, because it's still, there's so many, first of all, I've witnessed so many topics on future, transhuman, posthuman. You definitely see a big trend in that realm. It seems like it's something that triggers people's excitement. And when it comes to science, that's the future. But I think the reason why we gather here and talk about it is, you know, still you need to hold on one second. Like, why do we need to do this? And in what sense we can actually to shape it to against a single, you know, historical writing, and to find more ways, more alternative ways to posit the relationship between us and others. Yeah, that's how I'm excited about, you know, Muribas, and we've been collaboratively working with so many other artists, the musicians, the mathematicians, all in this together. So I think my approach is to really research a new paradigm where, as Professor Bertoldi has said, we are all in this together, and what does that mean in relation, you know, to our current anxiety. Yes.
Thank you so much, Chiarina. This was so inspiring. And also a couple of theoretical references, if you have followed this beautiful inspirational conversation. Chiarina was also referring to a couple of works by Rosie Bredotti, which I really highly recommend for you to read, specifically Nomadic Subjects and also The Posthuman. So definitely two books that if you're interested in this topic and you want to look more into that, I would really highly recommend. I have one more question for Agathe, also in relation to her theoretical frame. In the case of Chiarina, Chiarina with Bredotti, in the case of Agathe, she's also working with the singularity, and I would like to ask her, how does this connect to the imaginary of the future? And again, Ray Kurzweil here comes into the conversation. So please, if you want to add a little bit about the singularity.
Sure. So actually, I'm also a lot referring to Bredotti's work. I think it's a very good way to seize what she calls the figurations. And I'm really interested in the way we can spot current figurations of posthuman bodies and create new figurations as well. As concerns the singularity, Ray Kurzweil's singularity, that is going to happen, according to him, in 2029 now, I think. I'm really intrigued by the way this idea of singularity refers to, as you also mentioned, a very linear way of thinking time. It's really related to time, I think, and to our current connection and presence in the here and now. So I find this narrative and this myth, in a certain way, very interesting and very creepy as well. Interesting in the way that it predicts basically that artificial intelligence, or what we call artificial intelligence, will take on the human bodies, the human minds, in 2029, and we have no choice but merge with this artificial intelligence or die, according to him. So it's a very dualist narrative as well, and it's based on fear. And that's one of my main points, is that if we only build our future narratives and desires based upon fear, and based upon a very straightforward way of looking at time, we're doomed. So my almost political stand, I guess, is to say that we should probably think in a very more cyclical way and altogether, and also to take on those technological devices and technological knowledges. For example, what is artificial intelligence? What type of artificial intelligence do we live with today? Mostly machine learning, deep learning. Is it intelligence? For sure, no. But what is intelligence? There's some incredible intelligence in nature, for example. So just to deconstruct a bit all of those words and try to like retrieve power, retrieve technological knowledge and time knowledge as well, to build other narratives. That's really important, I think.
Okay, thank you so much. We're almost out of time, but I do have one more question for Chiarina. Very briefly, what can art bring to this conversation? What can art bring to the conversation of reimagining the future, reimagining posthuman bodies?
I think that's a very important question, because when it comes to art, I think it raises a force of energy that it's some, I don't know if I, correct me if I use the right word, that it kind of transcends a pure rational stage. So it is that it's based on, of course, a logic and rational realization, but then artists can really trigger that type of force that, you know, that's why we set this whole series of transformative performances in old theater. It's almost as if you can, you know, like think of a Brecht, the theatrical writer. It's to persist you there and to re-trigger that fundamental units inside your mind. I think that's what art and especially performance and music can do, to trigger that break, and then to kind of invite people and engage with, you know, this whole idea. So I always think that art and technology and all this should be one. It should be together. It should be together, and we are all together in that. Yeah. I don't know.
Fantastic.
If I,
yeah, this is a perfect way actually to end this conversation, which is also a beginning. So please make sure to go to watch the beautiful work that Chiarina is putting together with Moon, Magic Back in Town, to Town in New York, and also coming soon to your city. And also follow, please, the work of Agathe Francois. She's also going to come out soon with her PhD dissertation and her book on this. So I would like to thank so much both Chiarina and Agathe for being here for us today. This is such an interesting conversation on the posthuman. More on our website, posthumans.org. We are at NYU. We do have summits happening every season, and then global summits every 2 years. So please feel free to send our proposals, your ideas, and share with us the re-envisioning of the future. Thank you so much, Agathe and Chiarina, for this fantastic conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.